This is Awaken Your Rainbow Body. This is the updated and expanded March 2024. So I've done three other presentations throughout 4 years on this subject. So this is a fourth installment. And every time I do a presentation, it's for I've gathered more information, different realizations, different studies, and I update and expand upon what I had and what's going on with the presentation. So everyone is some repeated information, and then a lot of it is expanded upon, created and presented by me, Nicolas Illumin, part of Torrent Collective. So Torrent Collective is spiritual healing and awakening services in Portland, Oregon. torrentcollective.com. And here we'll have like a little table of contents. So what's going to go down here? So what this is, so we'll start with the Tibetan Rainbow Body, an introduction, a history of origins, and then real life documented cases. Then we'll move into transhumanism. We'll give a brief introduction with my thoughts around what transhumanism is, and then how it relates to the Rainbow Body and the Light Body. We'll move into Gebchak Gonpa nuns, who they are, and an outline of their practices, for they are holding teachings and practices that have been handed down through this woman lineage, specifically around the Tibetan Rainbow Body, for their nuns that are there till this day who have frequent Rainbow Body death occurrences. So we'll go over what they do and how this is a very specific practice system. And we'll go over the outline of their practices. And then finally, we'll close with some suggested thoughts and practices for Westerners. So ideas and thoughts on how to live slash be related to those who have had a rainbow body occurrence, and how we can show up fully for life and live out our true life's purpose based on taking examples from people who have had rainbow body occurrences, from the practice system, and how we can relate it to our life living in the West. But more on that later. So I want to first, before we move on, give thanks, honor, and respect to all my past, present, and future teachers, to all the Tibetan lamas, lay people, and yogis who have hold these teachings and mastery, and to all the yogis and practitioners living in remote places doing extreme practices and prayers from all around the world, and to all the beings of past, present, and future who practice and teach the Tibetan Rainbow Body and other light body teachings. I honor you and thank you and give much respect and humbly bow. So with that being said, I just want to put a little disclaimer here, because I am going to be recording this, just the video, and putting it online. So all ideas and information expressed in this presentation and video are for entertainment and information purposes only. Do not try to copy, practice, or imitate anything stated here. And if you do, you do so at your own risk. It is suggested to always partake in a spiritual practice or exercise under the supervision and guidance of a trained professional. The information shared here is not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or replace proper medical care, and always consult a licensed healthcare professional before making any significant modification to your well-being or lifestyle. All materials in this presentation video are used for entertainment purposes and fall within the guidance of fair use, no copyright infringement intended. If you are or represent the copyright owner of materials used in this video, please reach out to me, torrentcollective@gmail.com. All right, part one, the Tibetan Rainbow Body, also called the Rainbow Light Body. So when a practitioner has a death experience, four main things can happen to be considered a rainbow body death occurrence. So one, the body remains in a meditation posture for 3 to 7 days, and in rare cases, a couple of weeks before showing any signs of decomposition. Over the course of about 7 days, the clinically dead body shrinks to the size of a small child or baby. And then over the course of about 7 days, the clinically dead body shrinks and then disappears or dissolves leaving only hair, nails, and teeth sometimes. And then finally, the most rarest of cases, the body does not have a death experience, but completely disappears into rainbow light while the person is alive. It is said that about 1 to 2 of these cases a year happen within the Tibetan Buddhism tradition. And it doesn't account for other spiritual traditions or people who are hermits and alone living in places that people have no idea what they're doing. But about documented cases where there's an eyewitness, it's said about 1 or 2 of these occurrences happen about a year. So, definition of the rainbow body, how one practices it, according to rigpawiki.org, which is a website like Wikipedia, but about mainly about Tibetan Buddhism. And this is the definition found there. So rainbow body, fully accomplished Dzogchen practitioners can dissolve their body at the time of death. We'll go over Dzogchen later. Through the practice of Tretchko, the practitioner can attain the so-called rainbow body, in which the body becomes smaller and smaller as it dissolves, animating rainbow light, and finally only the hair and nails are left behind. Through the practice of Togal, the practitioner can dissolve his or her body into the light body, where the body transforms into light and disappears completely into space. And we'll go over the practice of Dzogchen, Tretchko, and Togal later. So what is the light body in my own words? Practitioners who have a rainbow light body, practitioners of the rainbow light body practice ways of mastering their mind, emotions, and energies of the body through very specific practices and modalities that involve, but not limited to, some very intense devotion, meditation, yogas, and understanding of the laws of the universe and the true nature of mind and body. So rainbow body physical death experience can be a byproduct of the human's life. They die how they live. To be able to be in a balanced state of clarity, love, wisdom, compassion, and pure presence to the moment beyond thought. This may be the state of being that allows the body to dissolve into light, combined with specific and sometimes extreme in nature practices and ways of living. More on this later. So here's a quote by Albert Einstein. Concerning matter, we have all been wrong. What we have called matter is energy, whose vibration has been so lowered as to be perceptible to the senses. There is no matter. So let's go to the origins and kind of history and examples of people who have attained the rainbow body, starting with Padmasambhava. Padmasambhava means lotus-born, also known as Guru Rinpoche, which means precious master. He is said to be the second Buddha who was extremely influential in the creation of the Nyingma lineage of Tibetan Buddhism, and was a big impact upon the creation of Vajrayana Buddhism, Tantric Buddhism. He is said to be one of the first to practice and teach the rainbow body here on earth. At the time of Padmasambhava's death, it is said that he burst into pure rainbow light in front of his 20 main students and consorts and continued to teach in his light body even after his physical body dissolved. It is said that he, quote, came from the heavens on a lotus flower, which has people thinking he is from another planet possibly, and came here to teach humans about the rainbow body. He's left only puzzle pieces of the rainbow body teachings throughout Tibetan Buddhist Dzogchen teachings and Nyingma teachings and all the teachings in Tibetan Buddhism. But there is no manual on how to practice this that I'm aware of to the Western public. And here is a picture of him. This is a statue that they say is one of the first and resembles greatly what he looked like in the energy of him. So as we look through all these different images, especially the ones showing the Tibetan rainbow body art and showing some of the actual practitioners of Tibetan rainbow body, I invite you to really feel what comes up within your body, within your mind, what changes occur, how, notice your breath and just really feel and present and be present with whatever is occurring, and just kind of take note on what you experience when you see or hear something. Because they say that in Tibetan art, that the art itself, so this is a tanka of Padmasambhava. Usually these are all done by hand using natural colors and dyes, and they hold the energy of what they're expressing. So this is Padmasambhava in his form before he dissolved into light or passed away into rainbow body. So it says that the images themselves, just by looking at them, can activate the same energy that they hold within yourself. Here is Alex Gray's depiction of a painting of Padmasambhava. Here is a tanka of Padmasambhava in rainbow body. Usually, like many Tibetan Buddhist art, there's different deities or protectors surrounding. There's green Tara in the bottom left, the female Buddha of compassion. On the top left, Manjushri, the Buddha of wisdom. Chenrezig, Buddha of compassion. And Vajrapani, Buddha of protection, of power. Here's a close-up of that tanka. And the rain, they always show usually these rainbow rays coming out from the heart and the third eye center. Here's another one. And another. So some yogis, some masters, before they leave a body, their physical body, they'll leave relics. And this is said to be a handprint of Padmasambhava in rock. So sometimes yogis who are deeply devoted to practice, they attain what we call siddhis, or like superpowers. And that's what they say. This is one that they can move through rock, they can move through walls, is a city. So this is like a relic to me, is like a reminder of what's possible for the human to experience. So this is what this is depicting, the handprint of Padmasambhava. So moving on to his two main consorts, Yeshi Sogo and Mandrava. They were Padmasambhava's two main students, lovers, consorts, who he taught the Tibetan Rainbow Body to, who they also had supposedly Tibetan Rainbow Body death occurrences where they dissolved into light. And they were responsible for teaching many women these practices. Yongthak Yongtang Gompa, who is the founder of classical Tibetan medicine in 8th century, practiced, they say, the rainbow body and turned his body into pure light at the time of his quote-unquote death. And I say quote-unquote in death because I feel that they don't actually die. Death implies a lot of the time that we disappear, gone, end. So I quote death, especially in this case, because they just are now in a different form, a different vehicle, not this flesh and bone vehicle, but in a more pure light vehicle. He's disappeared, leaving no body behind, just like Padmasambhava, they say. And they also state that he did this with his wife, and his dog disappeared with him as well, which is very fascinating. Ayu Chandro, who they said to live to be about 113 years old, she is a Tibetan Buddhist yogini. So I don't know if she was actually Buddhist. This could have been before Buddhism time, for before there was Vajrayana and Tibetan Buddhism, there was the Bon tradition, which is like the traditional shamanic original spiritual tradition of Tibet. So I'm not sure if she was pre-Tibetan Buddhism or not. No, she was now 1836 to 1953. Never mind, I answered my own question. She was in the Tibetan Buddhist time, and she was a cave dweller. She lived in remote places, and she spent a lot of time, they say, in dark retreat, sometimes years in darkness. And she would come out and teach, and they say that when she died, she disappeared into light as well. So moving on to Jesus the Christ, Yeshua ben Yosef. Jesus's resurrection body or glory body is said to be the same as the Tibetan rainbow body as well. It is known that Jesus was studying yoga and meditation in Tibet and India during his missing years or lost years, as they say it, under the name of Isa. It is said that he was taught the rainbow body teachings during this time, and also reported that he mastered rainbow body teachings and other related practices when he was with his lover, Mary Magdalene, who helped him to integrate the practice and really bring it to life. It has been said that she assisted him with other spiritual light body activations and healings as well. For more on that information, I highly suggest the Magdalene Manuscript book by Tom Kenyon and Judy Sion. Jesus's original core teachings reflect the Tibetan Buddhist rainbow body and yogic teachings to me, and are truly the same at their core, for they are based on love, compassion, forgiveness, and that God is inside each and every one of us. Here is some art examples of Yeshua, Jesus, in his rainbow body form or activated light body. I don't know the artist of that last one and this one, but here we have Yeshua in the middle top sitting on a circular rainbow in a heavenly realm, while Archangel Michael or Mikael below fighting off demons and helping protect humanity. But, you know, they could have put him on anything, and it's interesting that he's on a rainbow. Here, William Holman Hunt has Yeshua, Jesus, with, again, a rainbow ring surrounding him. Ernest Fuchs, one of the first inventors, you can say, of visionary art of our time. He has Yeshua here with golden rays of light emanating from him. And again, Alex Gray's piece on Jesus. Again, these rays of light. The Shroud of Turin is a photo of this cloth, this fabric that was placed on Jesus after his crucifixion. When he was in his tomb, they put this piece of fabric on him, like this linen. And this piece of fabric has been found, and they call it the Shroud of Turin. And this is on the left, some sort of a photograph of this impression that was left on the cloth that resembles the shape of a body. On the right is kind of an enhanced version of like the details of what it could look like with more detail. And the most significant thing about this to me is that the cloth, there's one side of the cloth where the fabrics of the cloth have been seared, have been like scorched with some sort of intense heat. So they looked it under like a microscope and saw that there was like a burning sensation, like it got burned. So they are speculating that something of great heat exploded while that sheet was on him. So to me, that could be showing signs that he dissolved or his body transformed into light. Moving on to more yogic type of side of these, of the rainbow body. So the rainbow body is what the Tibetans call our body turning into light body. So we are made of light and darkness and energy. So light body is what we are all made of. It's kind of like an umbrella topic to this. And the rainbow body is what the Tibetans call when the body dissolves into light. and how the body and the practices that could lead up to that. But this is found in all spiritual traditions, almost all spiritual traditions throughout the world. There is some sort of case or documentation of the body dissolving into light, and practices that could possibly have that as a byproduct. So we have Babaji, who is said to be immortal, where he keeps like disappearing and coming back and disappearing and coming back hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. And they say that he has been seen dissolving into light as well. Ramalinga Swami, who's part of that lineage and tradition, was, I believe, in the early 1900s, don't quote me on that though, where he actually dissolved into light in front of a group of people. And it was like a public event where this happened. And then we have part of that same lineage of the Mahasiddha lineage. We have Matrasandranath and Goraknath. So we have student teacher on the left and then a student on the right. They say that these masters also had a light body occurrence with eyewitnesses and a lineage of these teachings being passed down. His Imperial Majesty, Haile Selassie, who is the emperor, was the emperor of Ethiopia. He is very big. Rastafarians see him as the second coming of Jesus. And they say he was in a prison cell at the end of his life. And it was reported that he also disappeared into light, quote unquote, because when they went to go feed him dinner one time or do a check in the cell, he was completely gone with nothing remaining in there. And there was, quote unquote, no way for him to get out. But the fact that he is highly seen and holds the same qualities as Yeshua, Jesus, and there's all these different prophecies that he is the second, an embodiment of the Christ energy, that he possibly dissolved into light as well. So part two here is the different forms of the rainbow light body. And we're going to break them down. And we'll have time for questions and answers at the end of this. So if you have any questions, please write them down. So tuktum. Tuktum, according to, again, wigpawiki.org, is when a realized practitioner continues to abide by the recognition of the nature of mind at the moment of death and awakens into the ground luminosity, quote, fundamental inherent nature of everything, when it manifests. He or she may even remain in that state for a number of days. Some practitioners and masters die sitting upright in that state for a number of days, sometimes weeks. Some practitioners and masters die sitting upright in meditation postures, and others in the posture of the sleeping lion. Besides their perfect pose, there will be other signs that show they are resting in the state of ground luminosity. There is still a certain color and glow in their face. The nose does not shrink inward, and the skin remains soft and flexible. The body does not become stiff, and the eyes are said to be kept a soft and compassionate glow, and the area around the heart stays warm. Great care is taken that the master's body is not touched and silence is maintained until he or she has arisen from this state of meditation. So here are some actual photos of people in this tuktum state. So the person dies, quote unquote, the vital signs stop. There's no heartbeat, there's no brain activity, there's no pulse, but they die sitting upright or laying down with no support. They'll remain in this posture. The skin stays soft and elastic. There's a warmth in the heart. And again, this happens from 3 days to 2 weeks, it's been reported. There's no odors. There's no rigor mortis. Here's another. I don't know the name of these two masters. These photos are a little tricky to find. But here is another lama in the state of tuktum. They say they're in a deep meditative state, so there's some part of the mind, the consciousness, that is still doing something in what we call the bardo, in what the Tibetan Buddhists call the bardo, the in-between state between life and death. There's still something going on there, which is keeping the body in this state. But it is quite a mystery to us who do not, again, practice these very specific practices. A more recent case, Tenga Rinpoche. Again, he's just leaning back on some pillows. He only has one leg. His leg got amputated at the knee from, I think, diabetes. And the most recent case that I am aware of is Lama Zapa Rinpoche, who is a beautiful master. He died in Tukdum, they say, and these are photos, I believe, after Tukdum. So after the Tukdum experience is complete, because they say when it's complete, the head drops downward. So moving on to some more cases of Tukdum, Chogya Trichen in 2007. He was in Tukdum for, I believe, a week. And this is obviously a photo of when he was alive. So one thing that I am very fascinated with is taking the qualities, the attributes, the personality, the practices, the ways of being that these people have lived and embody, and then using them to apply as almost like role models to our life and how to live the most compassionate, loving, joyful, in service life we can live, living out our true life's purpose. How can we take what they've done, what they express, like just looking at this photo, just feeling what you're feeling, how that is helping us to embody it. So that is one of the main reasons I'm doing this work in this presentation. A nun from Gebchak Gonpa in Eastern Tibet, who we will go over later, that nummery. This is Ani Lama Sherpa Zamba. Hello.
Sorry,
you're here for the presentation?
Yes.
Okay,
sorry,
come on in. Did you get mixed up with the daylight savings time thing?
Well, a little bit.
Okay,
yes.
Come on in, no problem. We're about 20 minutes in.
Okay, thank you.
Have a seat, welcome.
Thank you.
What's your name?
I'm John.
I'm Elizabeth.
Hello, welcome.
And you are?
I'm Nicolas. Thanks
pleasure.
For being here.
And these two?
Hi, I'm Krista.
Krista, nice to meet you.
Scott,
nice to meet you.
So, how familiar are you? Do you have any experience with the Tibetan Rainbow Body knowledge?
I do. She's new. But
okay.
I've studied a little bit.
So this is all going to be recorded, and I could send you this recording link.
Wonderful.
When we're done, so you can kind of catch up. But we're looking at people who, actual physical people who have showing, who have had a rainbow body life occurrence. So this is Ani Lama Sherab Zamba, who's a nun from Gebchak Gonpa, a nunnery in Eastern Tibet. She was a high nun who was gave many teachings, who showed many signs of accomplishment. And they say she shrunk, she was in Tukdum for 2 weeks.
Tukdum's when the body doesn't...
Tukdum is when the body dies, the heart rate and the mind stop, cease, but it stays upright or laying down in a posture without showing any signs.
Right.
Can you move over a smidge
yes,
to your
will,
right
so
I can see your eyes?
And I can see you.
Yeah, so when they're either in a state of meditation or they're lying down, for 3 days to many weeks, but the body shows no signs of rigor mortis, the skin stays elastic, the heart, the area of the heart stays warm. So I'm showing examples of
gotcha.
That right
Thank
now.
You.
She was in that state for 2 weeks. His Holiness, the 16th Karmapa, Rangdrang Rinpa Dorje, is a pretty beautiful story. So he died in a hospital in Chicago. He had some sickness. And he was in Tukdum, I believe, for a week, laying in his hospital bed. Skin was soft and elastic. The area around his heart, they say, was burning hot the whole time. And even after, you know, heartbeat, brain activity ceased. And it was he showed such compassion and kindness, even though he was in a state of suffering because he was sick and his body was dying, he still showed such love, and the energy in the room was so amazing that the nurses and the doctors that take care of him, it touched them so much that they created a little shrine in this hospital in Chicago to like honor him. But he was in Tukdum for about a week. And also he would have these black crown ceremonies. He did this tour in the late 70s early 1970s, 1980s, called this Black Crown Ceremony, where he would do it in America and Europe. That's a picture of him on the left, holding the black crown, embodying the Buddha of compassion. And during one of these experiences, someone took a photograph of him, and this is the photograph on the right, and this has been studied and researched and untampered with, and this is how the photograph came out. So they say that this could be showing a sign of the rainbow body, the luminous glory body on the right. It's very fascinating. If you want to learn more about Tukdom, there's this amazing documentary out called Tukdom Between Worlds. I believe it's on, like, you know, Amazon and all that stuff. And it's a very scientific approach. They take scientists and they go to people who are in Tukdom and check out what's going on. So that's an amazing documentary.
So Nicolas, to clarify, I think you already mentioned this, Tukdom, so scientifically, sort of medically, there's no brain activity, is there no pulse? But the body remains warm.
They are clinically dead.
The heart is stopped.
The brain activity is stopped. They are clinically pronounced deceased.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
But, mm-hmm. there is a heat source at the heart.
Correct.
So that's whatever that heat source is what's keeping. Well, who knows? But
possibly. Yeah. Probably. Yeah. Possibly.
Gotcha.
Cool. So let's move on. And I asked, just so we can get through the material, if you have questions, to write them down, and I'll address them at the end. Sound good? Thank you so much. Okay, so there's three, moving on to the rainbow body, there's three main types of what would be considered a rainbow light body death experience. That is, by seen by the viewer, right? What is the body's vital sign stop? The physical body remains seated in meditation position, or sometimes lying down, for around 7 days. During these days, the area around the heart stays warm, the skin remains elastic, and the body does not smell bad, but smells pleasant. Along with this, the physical body shrinks over the 7 days, give or take, sometimes longer, the size of a small child or baby. When this happens, the skin becomes fresh-looking, like that of a newborn infant. Another sign of rainbow body is the body shrinks and then disappears or dissolves into rainbow light, only leaving behind clothes, hair, finger, toenails, and sometimes other parts of the body. And the third type of rainbow body is where the body does not shrink at all, or even quote unquote die, but disappears completely into rainbow light while the person is still alive. So the most recent example of rainbow light body occurrences. So one of the most famous and most documented cases of this is that of Kempo Acha. And he was a Tibetan Buddhist Lama. He passed away in 1998. He was a hermit pretty much, but had students. And this event was actually documented and studied by Father Francis Tiso and funded by the Institute of Noetic Science. Many monks were eyewitness to Kempo Acho's rainbow body and death experience. Okay, so here's photos of him. And what's really remarkable about this case is that there was many eyewitnesses, and Father Francis Tiso, who we'll see in a minute, went there with a group of people 2 years after Lama Acha dissolved into light. And he had this where he was laying down. So he was in a hut. He was coming to the end of his life. He laid down on his right side. They covered him with a ceremonial cloth. Over the course of 7 days, he was not disturbed. The hut was sealed. They came back after 7 days and his body was completely gone. And when this happened, though, reports of light were beaming out of the windows, rainbows for the course of the 7 days, even though that there was a beautiful sunny day, were appearing, gatherings of wild animals were surrounding the hut, and mystical angelic sounds were being heard, pleasant smells, all these supernatural occurrences happen and have been reported happening around anyone, most people who have a rainbow body death occurrence. So here's Father Francis Tiso on the right, who's a who's a Catholic priest in Italy, but he is also a Tibetan Buddhist scholar and translator and has been studying the Tibetan Rainbow Body now for, I believe, over 30 years. And here is the book that he has written, Rainbow Body and Resurrection, Spiritual Attainment and the Dissolution of the Material Body and the Case of Kempo Acha. So if you want to go more into that case of him, I highly suggest this book. And what's really awesome about it is that he compares it to the resurrection body of Jesus. So it's speculated that Yeshua, Jesus, also knew these teachings and also dissolved into rainbow light, which they say is his glory body or resurrection body. So moving into some other actual recent cases of the rainbow body, here is Master Lama Achu Rinpoche. At the age of 84, he had his rainbow light body death experience in 2011. And he was a very loved and respected Lama. He lived close to Lama Acho, who we just saw. They were Dharma brothers, as they call them. And he is in Father Francis Tissot's book. Father Francis Tissot went to see this Lama and interviewed him and asked him questions about Kempo Acha and the rainbow body. And he actually stated that, hey, if you want to stick around, I'm probably going to dissolve into light and have this happen to me based on what I've been doing and signed, because he was close to the end of his life. He's like, if you want to stay around, I can teach you. My lamas can teach you if you want to know what's going on. And Father Francis Tissot said, well, how long would that take? And he said, 60 years or so. And Father Francis Tissot decided to go another route. But here is a photo of Lama Achu and taken when he was outside meditating. And again, no actual hard proof that this was not tampered with, but they say it wasn't, that this kind of glow surrounding him and this orb above his head almost looks like there's like a little Buddha in there. This photo has been highly studied, researched, dissected to see if it's been tampered with. And this is an old school photograph taken of Lama Achu in a dimly lit room at night. And this is how it developed. Oh, he was sitting and meditating near the end of his life. Sometimes when great masters, they die, he did shrink. So he shrinked significantly in size when he passed away. And when that happens, they'll wrap the body in ceremonial cloth, put a hat on them, put them in the stupa for some time before they cremate, usually the body. So this is him in his being honored and respected, with thousands of people were there at his funeral. And again, he showed the same signs as Lama Achu, with the rainbows and the gatherings of animals and all that stuff. So moving on to Lama Karma Rinpoche, where he passed in 2013, and they say his body shrunk down to 7 inches when he passed, showing the same signs of accomplishment of the rainbow body. So that's him on the left, and you can kind of see his hair sticking out there as he's wrapped up on the right. It's very rare to find photos of this. So there's not many, but I found here, I documented as much as I could. Tashi Lamo was a nun, and she shrunk at the time of her death down to 15 inches. And that's her in a cooler, wrapped up. Lama Sobzar on the left, alive, in the process of dying or has passed away on the right, possibly. And then after the process is complete, this is supposedly his shrunken body with a monk comparing size here. So here's a photo, again, showing an example of the master passed away, wrapped up in the ceremonial garb with a beautiful procession, a very honorable event happening with rainbows that will appear just kind of like everywhere. Hair and fingernails of Shardra Tashi Gyatson. So this is a nun who they say dissolved into light, leaving only hair and fingernails. Dandrab Chatsmo of the, again, the Gebchak Gonpa nuns of Eastern Tibet. This is her alive. And they say that she, I don't have definite proof on this, but they say that she had some sort of a rainbow body death occurrence as well. So this is one of the most recent ones that I found. I haven't found exactly this Rinpoche's name. I think it's something, Lama Pudzo or something like that, but please don't quote me on that. I have not found his exact name, but here he is alive near the end of his life. And this is fascinating. There are pictures of the actual process of him dying. These were leaked on Facebook by some, but a lot of these monks nowadays, they have cell phones, even if they're in remote places. So one of his students, whether it was intended or not intended, took photos of it, and it somehow got on the internet. But they're very hard to find these days. I found these about 4 or 5 years ago. Here he is, either dying or dead. And it seems that his body is shrinking. And again, I'll repeat this. I stated this earlier. As we view these photos and this art, like, notice what you feel in your body. Notice what comes up. Notice how you feel mentally, emotionally, physically within you, because it's just by looking at these images, viewing them through your eyes can activate the same type of energy within your body, of the rainbow body, of these type of mastery that these lamas hold. So what's interesting about these pictures is not just the body and what it's doing, but what's around them. So there's these colors of light, these different colors on these sheets in front of him that he was maybe staring at, or maybe it's a cover of a tanka, a different deity. So here again, seems like he's getting smaller. Here's another. And then this photo here, which again, we don't know if this has been messed with or altered. It doesn't feel like it. It doesn't look like it, but again, we don't know. But here we have a full-sized male lama next to this Rinpoche on the left. He could have been a small master to begin with, but we don't know. But there's definitely something going on. And again, it's very interesting what's in front of him. We have these spheres or colors of light that were placed in front of him, or he placed in front of him, that he was either observing or looking at, that have something to do with his experience. Okay, so that concludes a part two, and we'll be moving now into part three, which is transhumanism. I'm feeling a little chilly. I'm gonna turn on the heat so I can remain comfortable. You all need the bathroom, it's right here in this door. Okay, so transhumanism, who here has heard of this term? Raise your hand. Okay. So I'm going to talk about transhumanism, what it is, and why it relates to the topic. Transhumanism, our future. There are other organizations / cults in the world that want humans to ascend and transform as well. However, this type of transformation evolution is done not spiritually, organically, with one's own free will and power, but with technology. Tech and AI corporations see a future where humans and machines become one, where AI becomes intertwined with the human body, mind, and everyday human life. I believe that within us all is a core desire to ascend or to evolve, to become more than what we are now mentally, physically, spiritually. These major tech and AI corporations are following this inherent core desire, however, doing it in a way that I feel doesn't truly have humanity's best interest in mind, even though they might say they do. They want to make superhumans and make us immortal for their benefit and not in the name of love and light, in my opinion. This has already started. We are deep into this evolution. You're seeing the blending of AI with the human body already in many ways. It started with the iPhones and iWatches, and now with VR and Neuralink, it has become very much, quote, real. One goal that these major corporations have is for humans, is that eventually we use VR, virtual reality, all day long, with the end goal being to plug our consciousness and personalities into robots or hologram bodies of ourselves. Another goal is that we completely hook our entire consciousness mind with the internet and an AI simulated reality and drop our human bodies. We become an avatar AI quote unquote body interacting with other avatar people in a simulated virtual quote reality. This is what could be in store for humanity in the very near future. These tech corps are slowly getting us to rely and become addicted to technology, to essentially fall in love with it and want to become it, thus to greatly identify with our bodies, and at the same time fear and not love our bodies in the hope to abandon them altogether. I believe that the people in charge and running these corporations do not love us and do not have our best interests in mind, and they want us to ascend and evolve, but on their own behalf and for themselves. So, quote, they can be in control and feel powerful. We become slaves. Think of the movie, The Matrix. So the choice of your lifetime is now, in my opinion, do we evolve spiritually or digitally? Will you be clear enough within to make the best decision for yourself? So let me go into more detail about this. So this is something called Project 2045 Project, or the 2045 Initiative. And it's basically, here we have a timeline with the end goal being to put our consciousness into a hologram-like avatar. So we see on the right, Avatar A. A robotic copy of the human body remotely controlled by BCI, Avatar B, an avatar in which the human brain is transplanted at the end of one's life, Avatar C, an avatar with an artificial brain in which the human personality is transferred at the end of one's life, and Avatar D, the end goal being a hologram-like avatar. So you can go to their website. This is like a really many tech corporations, many of the major ones, and many very rich people in power are all backing this. Is this the future of humans on planet Earth? Can becoming a robot or living in an AI reality assist with the healing and awakening of mankind in the nature and love and light? Can we be a robot and live in a VR 24/7 and still truly love, have free will, and continue to heal and create as free creator gods? These are some of the questions I ask myself to determine what and why this is happening as a reality for some humans on Earth. Again, this is happening now. Many people are choosing to go down this timeline. What will you choose? My choice currently is to evolve spiritually and naturally in the name of love. So I feel this is why it is important to start/continue to practice spiritual practices to manage and master our mind, body, and energies, so that when the time comes to choose what direction we're going to go, AI body or a rainbow body, you will make a clear and empowered choice. But if you are not clear and playing along with their games and addictions, you might make a choice you may not be able to reverse. So here's Mark Zuckerberg, Facebook owner, CEO, at a conference when they first released their VR technology, Oculus. They created something called Facebook Spaces, which is not running anymore, to my knowledge, but basically you're either on your computer or in VR, you're connected to your Facebook profile, you make an avatar, and then you're in this type of simulated virtual reality interacting with other people's avatars. It had many bugs and did not work very well. Not people weren't that interested in it, so they kind of scratched that. But currently they're doing Facebook Infinite Office, where they are having people, they are suggesting that people go on to the VR Oculus system while they're at work and interacting with other people in meetings and conversations and working basically on your computer, but in this VR form with these goggles on. And here is a conference he had about this topic, or I find this wording very interesting. Our goal, 1 billion people in virtual reality. And I think the word in is interesting. It's not one people using, one people buying, one people playing, but one people in. I think that's fascinating. And you have Elon Musk, who is now just recently put the first Neuralink chip into a human being, where they're able to connect with all electronic devices and the internet just using their brain with his computer chip that he makes based on his company in the actual brain itself. So that's happening. And this is very fascinating. Here we have His Holiness, the Dalai Lama, with one of the main founder, creator, CEOs of the 2045 project. This was about 14 years ago. This has been going on for a while. This photo was taken, I believe, like 14 years ago. And he backs this project in the name of compassion and benefit of all beings. It's just fascinating that someone of his caliber, of his mastery, of who he is, thinks it's a good idea for this to happen. I just think that's curious. And there's a link to the article stating how he supports this idea and timeline. So yeah, I'll play it. Here's a video called Introducing Apple's VR goggles called Vision Pro. And then when this is done, I'll put all this together and how it relates to Rainbow Body. Let me put on my speaker.
Introducing Apple Vision Pro. The era of spatial computing is here. When you put on Apple Vision Pro, you see your world and everything in it. Your favorite apps live right in front of you, but now they're in your space. This is Vision OS, Apple's first ever spatial operating system. It's familiar, yet groundbreaking. You navigate with your eyes. Simply tap to select, flick to scroll, and use your voice to dictate. It's like magic. Apps have dimension, react to light, and cast shadows. Even though these spatial experiences are happening inside Vision Pro, it looks, sounds, and feels like they are physically there. Foundational to Apple Vision Pro is that you're not isolated from other people. When someone else is in the room, you can see them, and they can see you. Because you're not limited by a display, apps live in your space. Your photos can be life size or any size, so your living room becomes a gallery. And panoramas wrap around you as if you're right where you took them. Apple Vision Pro is Apple's first ever 3D camera. Now, you can capture photos and videos with remarkable depth. and relive a memory as if you're right back in the exact moment. Experiences on Vision Pro can also expand in three dimensions, filling the entirety of your space. Like in the mindfulness app, where you can create a moment of calm.
Okay, you get the point. Yeah? So, back here. It's important to note that I am not anti-technology. I'm using it right now, obviously. I think it's a great tool. I'm not anti-VR or AI. What's key, though, in my opinion, is how we use it and who is behind the making and designing of the technology. What is the manufacturer's, creator's intention and our intention of why we use it? So I feel this relates to this topic of the light body and the rainbow body, for this is something that's happening now where there are certain groups of people like Facebook and Google, these massive corporations who are really going down this timeline of wanting to do this to some people. And I don't know exactly, you know, who knows what can happen if we do decide to do something like this. Can we still evolve? What happens to our soul? What happens to our life force energy if we become or put our consciousness into a robot? If we are on VR all day, what's the health benefits of that? What are the risks of it? And can we still organically evolve and grow spiritually, mentally, emotionally, and have free will? So I feel that this is important to just be aware that this is going on and to be aware of your relationship with technology so that you don't make a choice that you may regret or that may harm you, and to decide kind of what path you're going to go down or merging of the paths. I know some people that are in technology and work with AI who are beautiful spiritual human beings who are actually using AI and technology as a tool for ascension, as a tool for healing, as a tool for helping people on their path. So I don't think it's black and white, but to just be aware that this is this could be a reality. It could be something that is happening. It's definitely happening, but the end goal, the whole, you know, ideas of why it's happening is in speculation, but to just have it in our awareness. So moving on to Gebchak Gonpa nuns. So back to the rainbow body. And I want to touch on this nunnery that is in Eastern Tibet. And what I have done is I have found some videos, there's some books, there's some talks about this remarkable lineage of nuns. For at this nunnery, they hold a lineage that dates back to Padmasambhava, who they say is one of the original teachers of the rainbow body here on earth. And some of these nuns are having rainbow body death occurrences to this day. And what I have done is I have found some of the practices that they do that could result in this type of mastery of mind, body, of emotions, this mastery of living a life of unconditional love and service and compassion. But to mainly show that rainbow body, I'll repeat this which is something I stated earlier, the rainbow body is a specific, very specific practice of Tibetan Buddhism and even beyond. So there's a light body teaching in many spiritual traditions from around the world, but the Tibetans call it the rainbow body. And I feel it's a byproduct of how people live and what they do. So here we're going to see example of how these nuns live, some of the practices they do that result in not just the rainbow body, but if you look at them and feel their energy, result in this like Christ Buddha-like qualities. So Gebchak Gonpa In the remote highlands of Nangchen, eastern Tibet, there exists an extraordinary lineage of female spiritual practitioners, one of the largest nunneries in Tibet, in the heart of renowned meditation tradition unique to women. Gebchak Gonpa is the mother nunnery of dozens of branch nunneries scattered throughout the region. It stands strong as a model community for more than 350 yogini nuns, exemplifying kindness, peace, and joyful adherence to spiritual practice for the benefit of the entire world. Many great Buddhist masters have praised Gebchak Gonpa as being unrevived in its spiritual training. Its nuns are famed for their accomplishments in profound yogas and meditation, while their compassion and dedication to the Dharma is remarkable. Gebchak Wandrak Rinpoche is one of the only males that lives there frequently and is their protector and cares for these nuns, but he's not necessarily their teacher. They basically teach themselves. So they have this unbroken lineage of mouth to word, of mouth to ear, hand to hand transmissions and teachings that the elder nuns teach to the younger nuns. But he is their main lama that is responsible for their protection and for their safety and to keep the whole place kind of running. And see how beautiful it is as well. Very, very remote in 16,000 feet up high, one of the remote places in the world. Here are some new nuns who are just kind of getting started in the nunnery. They usually start around the age of 14, 15 or 16. And most of them stay in there for their entire life in retreat. So now we'll go into the practice systems of Gebchak. And the whole reason I'm showing this is to kind of quote, stress the fact that this is their way of doing, of embodying the loving kindness, clarity, compassion, mastery of mind, body, and energies that result sometimes in a rainbow body experience, which is said to be, like in the Tibetan tradition, ultimate enlightenment or a sign of ultimate mastery or achievement. And you know that what that means is different to all people. But the reason I want to show this is that this is their way. And unless you decide you're going to be a monk or a nun and dedicate your entire life to this, you can take on this way and go and join a nunnery or a monastery, but to not copy it, which I have done and I feel a lot of people have done. And I'll talk more about that later. So I want to go through this, and this is what they go through at Gebchak. This is not all of it. This is just what I have found, because they're obviously not going to talk about everything they do and experience. A lot of it is secret and kept very in closed doors type of thing. So practice systems at Gebchak. A nun joins a nunnery at around 16 or 17. And the first task is to look over the nunnery yak. So they have about 200 yak, and they do this for 2 years, where their only job is to take care of the yak, to feed them, to milk them, to clean their dung and gather their dung, their poop for fuel. After the 2 years, she can then formally enter the nunnery practice system. After this, some preliminary practices are done for over 4 months, and there's two forms of this. There's the outer preliminaries, which are, one, the freedoms and advantages of a precious human rebirth; two, the truth and impermanence of change; three, the working of karma; and four, the suffering of living being within samsara. The inner preliminaries are, one, taking refuge in the three jewels in conjunction with the performance of 100,000 prostrations, which are purifying pride; two, cultivating bodhicitta, which is purifying jealousy; three, 100,000 recitations of the Vajrasattva 100 syllable mantra, purifying hatred and aversion; 100,000 mandala offerings, purifying attachment; and 100,000 guru yoga practices, purifying delusion. After that, they go into, I don't know how linear this is, right? But after that, the preliminary practices are complete. The nuns do 200 days of nungnes, which are like a fasting and deep ceremony retreats to different deities. A 7-month Vajrakalaya retreat, which is a protector deity. Then they do the traditional 3-year retreat with about 20 other nuns. And in this retreat, they're in a small space, like a little hut, And they're in these little cubicles, which they sleep in. They sleep sitting up. You'll see pictures of this. And they're with these other nuns. For 3 years, they don't leave that retreat and the little area surrounding it. And they don't see anyone else besides the people they're there with for 3 years. And in this retreat, they'll do tulkor, which is like a hatha yoga practice of poses and breathing practices, which purify nadis and consciousness. They go over and practice the six yogas of Naropa, which are Tummo, the yoga of inner heat or mystic heat, Ajo, the yoga of clear light, radiance, and luminosity, Milam, the yoga of dream states, a dream yoga, Gulo, the yoga of the illusionary body, Bardo, the yoga of the intermediate state, and the Pawa, the yoga of transference of consciousness to the pure Buddha land. After the three-year retreat is complete, the nuns practice tulkor, meditation, prostrations, mantras, text prayers, and more on the daily. They do these practices alone in group rituals that last for days and reoccur multiple times a year. They practice advanced Dzogchen, which we'll go over later, teachings and rituals. This includes 100-day sets of togal, sky gazing, and other meditations in small boxes dug in the earth. The illusory body practice to prepare for the bardo. Cho practices, which is cutting through the ego, where Cho, the practitioner, seeks to tap the power of fear through the activities such as rituals set in graveyards and visualization of offering their bodies in a tantric feast in order to put their understanding of emptiness into the ultimate test. Then the multiple dark meditation retreats, where they go into complete darkness for sometimes 3 days, 7 days, or even months. They sleep upright in meditation boxes so they can practice dream yoga. And they do all this and more while surviving in very harsh mountain environments. And they do all their own chores, their own cooking, their own cleaning, taking care of their sick and building and maintenance while they do all these practices. They also have these chure, wet sheet tummo ceremonies, which last about 45 minutes. We'll see a little video of this. And they do this in the winter, so in the Himalayas, very, very high up, one of the remote highest places of the earth. It's negative 20 degrees Fahrenheit. And this is a public demonstration of their mastery of Tummo, where they're shirtless. They take sheets that they dip in water, and then they put the sheets on them, and they walk around the monastery. And then doing this breathing practice and activating basically their kundalini energy, they dry the sheets, and they do this like 3 or 4 times to kind of, it's a demonstration, but it's also a way of, again, like relics, showing what's possible for the human body and mind. So Dzogchen is a practice that they do, and it's a practice that is in Tibetan Vajrayana Buddhism that they say leads to a rainbow body experience. And my goal with presenting this, again, is not to give examples on how to have a rainbow body experience, teachings of how we can do this. It's, again, to show what these beings who have a rainbow body or life body death, taking them, again, as role models, as examples, and taking how they live their life, how they practice, how they live, how they talk, how they walk, how they sit, and using it and applying what they do and suiting it and tailoring it to us people in the West and how we can embody and live some of the same qualities. Dzogchen is a practice, is a more like advanced practice of Vajrayana Buddhism. It's called the Great Perfection or Great Completeness, and is one of the most ancient and direct stream of wisdom within the Tibetan Buddhist tradition. As a way in which to realize the inherent most nature of mind, that which we really are, Dzogchen is the clearest, most effective, most relevant to the modern world. Dzogchen is both the final and the ultimate teaching, and at the heart of the teachings of all Buddhas. Through generally associated with the Nyingma, or ancient school of Tibetan Buddhism, they say founded by Padmasambhava, Dzogchen has been practiced throughout the centuries by masters of all the different schools as their innermost practice. Its origins reach back to before human history, and neither it is limited to Buddhism nor to Tibet, nor indeed even to this world of ours, as it is recorded that it has existed in 13 different world systems. And again, this is from wigpawiki.org. So This practice, they say, if you practice these two advanced forms, Trecho and Togo, which we're going to go over briefly, the result is people who have mastered this or are deeply involved in this practice, which is designed for monks and nuns and ascetics. People who practice this deeply have a rainbow body experience. So again, we're going to touch over what it is and then break it down and how we can maybe have some pointers or suggestions how we can take on similar ideas for us living in the West. So Trecho is a collection of practices, many of which have deep roots in Buddhism and non-Buddhist spiritual systems, for skillfully focusing the mind without fixating the mind, perfecting breathing practices and meditations on the five skandhas, five aggregates of clinging, matter, sensations, perception, formations, and consciousness. It is a skillful way to do with what we are and what our possibilities are as an embodied consciousness. And this again is a quote from Father Francis Tissot in an interview that I did with him. So that's Trecho, which is a whole practice that's like a summarized form of the Dzogchen practice of Trecho. And this is the practice of Togal, a series of practices working with light that is done after mastering the first stage, Trecho, usually starting with the moon and then the sun. You stare at the moon and then the sun at various times, working with the light from the moon and the sun, gazing upon it and receiving the light as energy that activates subtle energies in the body. Dark retreats are done then where you are completely in the dark via a cave or a hut for 3 days, 7 days, or weeks, or months, sometimes years. You engage in this practice, you engage in the practices that you have memorized in the darkness. This includes physical yogas and tantric rituals, best to be done in a quiet, natural setting. The light that you see in the dark retreat is the natural light of the cells of one's body, which are biophotons, one can say. And these biophotons are connected with the biochemical processes of your genetic structure in the nucleus of the cell and the protein synthesis part of the cell that is directed and energized by that light. So one can focus in a way where one can observe it, and you become a true expert in the body of light as it already is inside of you. You can say you become very familiar with this territory. And again, this is quote directly from Father Francis Tissot. So here is the Dalai Lama's photographs of some of the Dalai Lama's secret temples. There's a secret temple that the Dalai Lama has that was kept secret for some time, but then photographs were allowed to be taken. And there's a book that was created about it. And these are some photos of it. There's not many clear photos of it on the internet, so I found what I could. But these photos are representing the practices of Dzogchen, of Trecho, of Togal, that could lead to the rainbow body, that these ascetics, that these yogis, these extreme practitioners do, and as well as other practices in the Bon and Tibetan tantric yogic traditions. So here we have, it looks like Padmasambhava, Guru Rinpoche. We have a yogi on the left with these deities and this rainbow light on the right. These are some close-ups of this wall, these murals. You got these yogis on the top with these, again, colored orbs above their heads. These Buddhas in this rainbow light. You have these yogis practicing different yogas. Again, with these colored, there's orbs, these colored rainbow rings. Togal could also be called Togal yoga. So a lot of it has to do with different postures and gazing and working again with the sun and the moon. There's a lot going on here. The bottom is showing sky burial. So sky burials in Tibetan Buddhism and in Tibet in general, when people die, they take them up to the site and someone will cut the body up after it's dead and feed it to vultures and wild animals. here's a yogi seeing or visualizing or experiencing, again, these different spheres with different Buddhas, deities in them. Here, to me, this is a depiction of Tummo, which is also can also be called the raising of Kundalini energy. So again, this is I just have this aha moment that I'll talk about a little later. I have taken on a lot of these practices, as many of us maybe have done. Like, we see these practices from different meditation traditions, these yogas, these Tibetan Buddhist practices, or any type of practice, and we apply them. We kind of like watch a video or read a book or maybe take a class or what have you, or even have a teacher, and we do these practices. But I feel there can be benefit to that greatly if you do it in a way that has a teacher and a guide, and you do it safely and in your own way. There can be an immense benefit, and positive things can happen from that. But these specific practices of Rainbow Body and Dzogchen and Togal, they're made for these type of people. They're made for people who are in caves, living in remote places in Tibet or India, who are dedicating their life to these types of practices and ways of being. And I think I'm extremely fascinated by it. I think this is a really, this is something that could be known by all people, like what Rainbow Body is and how possibly it happens. But in the next chapter, we're gonna move on to, now what does it mean for people like us? Like, here we see them practicing different yoga poses, or they call Tibetan yoga. Like the yoga we practice from India, Hatha yoga, it's very important that you have a teacher, or like if you were going to lift weights, or you're going to even like do massage work, there's a training, there's a certain embodiment that needs to happen. And to just be mindful to not just start doing something because you think you have a knowledge of it, because this specific system is very specifically designed to have a very specific result. Here's one of the walls, of multiple walls, of a blown back up of what we just saw. So here we have the Gebchak Gonpa nuns in a 3-year retreat. They let their hair grow, and those little boxes, those little seats, which are very comfy, they say they very much enjoy being in them. They live in them, and they'll sleep in them. They do their rituals in them. It's like their little home. And these are some very rare pictures of them during the 3-year retreat process. Here is someone practicing, which seems to be the Togal of the Dzogchen system. They're in these little dugout huts in the earth. Here are a group of nuns that just completed their 3-year retreat. As you can see, they look very healthy, and happy, and glowing, even though they live in very extreme rustic conditions. Okay, and here is a short video of a documentary called Trail of Light that was created, where they followed this nun who was searching for Rainbow Body teachings. She's a wandering young who goes to Gebchak Gonpa.
我的天啊，这太多人了，什么的，早餐你干了，你也是早餐的，早餐人你干了，那你妈在早餐里干嘛呢？我干嘛？你妈在做，那你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在做，你妈在 And oh my God. Then become that.
I'm not going to be able to do it.
I'm not going to be able to do it. They can't get the name given it. They can't give him a mahole.
The name, Lama Yona, we let my Yona get the rest together in the hotel with it. The name, they can't give my that way, Tia, which that they can't go around you. Give my Tia Dera, you to that. The name, Ariane, she has some of the give my Tia Puru, they'll get to me. And he's a joke.
I don't know. Go on.
The ceremony of magic heat, once common in many places in Tibet, has all but disappeared. Gebchak is the last place where this ritual procession still takes place. The nuns of Gebchak remain in constant meditation. Even during the night, they don't sleep in beds. They rest sitting upright in their cubicles to meditate. By controlling their breath and holding special postures, the nuns learn to master their energies. They can regulate their body temperature and penetrate the clear light of their dreams.
Okay, so how to put all this into practice, quote unquote, for Western people. And again, this isn't like a how to achieve the rainbow body for Westerners type of thing, because I have no idea. This is a how do we take these people who are having rainbow body death occurrences, who are showing signs of mastery, of accomplishment, of unconditional love, of what we call ascended masters, the energy of the Jesus, of the Christ, of the Buddha. How do we take those people, how they live, how they be, and apply some of that to our life in a way that's practical for people living in cities and people engaged in Western affairs? Because again, those practices, as you can see from the Gebchak women, are like a life dedicated practice, like the Dzogchen and the high Buddhist practices, is designed for those people. So what's designed for us is kind of like a goal that I have in creating. But what I first want to break down is this quote from that nun who was talking about her sister shrinking. She said, "When the mind is perfectly still, one finds only natural love. Seeing suffering in the world, compassion arises from its own accord. One sees all beings, even flies and worms, and one's own parents. And there's a natural desire to completely drain the ocean of suffering. To help others, we first seek to perfect ourselves. We meditate. But when you reach natural love beyond thoughts, all effort is abandoned. Realize this, and you'll attain the rainbow body." It's like that. So I think that's pretty profound for someone of her caliber, of who she is, of what she does, to say this type of a quote. So I broke it down on what it means to me in a practical way. So when the mind is perfectly still, one finds natural love, is the first sentence. So mind perfectly still to me equals meditation. So engaging in some sort of a meditation practice. Seeing suffering in the world, compassion arises from its own accord. Compassion to me equals open/heal your heart, /do your shadow work, do your trauma work, go through the healing that's necessary for you in this lifetime so that you can feel that compassion for others. One sees all beings, even flies, worms, as one's own parents, and there's a natural desire to completely drain this ocean of suffering. Again, that's compassion and love, but having unconditional compassion and love, as Jesus has said, and Buddha and all these other great beings pictured in the room have said. To help others, we first seek to perfect ourselves, we meditate. But when you reach the natural love beyond thoughts, all effort is abandoned. So perfect ourselves, to me, that's meditation, yoga, quote, self-mastery via the tools and practices that we have as living human beings to do what is needed, what our bodies and minds are wanting, to purify karma, to feel as healthy as we can in our bodies and our minds so we can get to a state of reaching natural love beyond thoughts, which to me is, again, is meditation in action, where all life is spiritual. All things, all moments is spiritual, and all of life becomes sacred. And then the all effort of abandon quote is to me learning how to deeply surrender to what is. And then the last quote, realize this and you'll attain the rainbow body. The realize this part to me is move from ignorance to wisdom and love. Okay, so in closing, I'm going to go from a very specific to a very general thoughts and ideas of how to take everything we just saw, to take from my life's experience and studying and practicing of studying ascended masters and practicing different yogas and Tibetan Buddhism, and how do we find, what is a way that we can have a tangible, practical way of living and being, as having them as role models, of having them as influences, as examples of what it is to be a fully loving, compassionate human being, living out our true life's purpose, like whatever that means. So going from specific to general, so from specific here, we have two main aspects of Vajrayana Buddhism for Westerners, in my opinion. This can be some ideas. The true nature of mind, becoming crystal clear with everything we say and don't say, do and don't do, think and don't think. Cultivating great awareness to what is. Complete mindfulness by paying attention to what is unfolding internally and externally in every moment. realizing that whatever we perceive through our senses or think in our mind is ultimately not us, and whatever we are perceiving the I, who we really are, cannot be found there. No one truly exists there. So we go beyond identifying with ourselves, with the body, our emotions, our gender, our personality, our race, our job, our status, achievements, etc. So we are those things, but it's not truly who we are. We go through whatever healing is necessary to transmute karma, past abuse, trauma, flawed beliefs, etc. And in doing this, we feel a deeper connection with the God source within us and all things. We blend deliberately with the space and the silence that surrounds all form. All tension in our body and mind can be released. We are all things and at the same time, nothing. So then the other component of this is the love and compassion and forgiveness. From living in this natural state of being, we can then deliberately choose to fill ourselves up with the energies and emotions that are the closest related to God's source energy, love, compassion, forgiveness, and joy, and all emotions, in my opinion. Living out these emotions, all emotions and feelings, all feelings throughout our entire lives as much as possible, look for reasons to love, practice being compassionate, and allow ourselves to forgive ourselves and others fully. Love everything and everyone through thoughts, words, and actions, and keep our connection to the source love energy even when we are seeing someone or something negative or seeing someone suffering in some way, trusting that everything is always working out for us and everyone, ultimately. Amma, the hugging saint, is a wonderful example of this, for she demonstrates true compassion. Forgiving ourselves for all things and making peace and falling in love with ourselves. From there, forgiving all others for all things, just as they say Jesus did and says. Allowing ourselves to be filled up with that which is true, real, whole, holy, and pure. There is this simplified practices that have been suggested by, called the Six Steps of Mastery from Kryon, who's channeled by Lee Carroll. And these are six steps of self-mastery, with the first one being fear. So what are we afraid of? What brings us to that state of stop, of freeze, of flight, of our greatest fear? Suggestion and invitation is to like move into that, discover that, dive into it, where it no longer has a strangle grip hold on us, a crippling effect on us. The two, the ego, all know that is having a balance with our ego. I don't believe we can release or destroy the ego. I think it's here to assist us with creating and connecting with life and humanity. So to have a balance, relationship with your ego. Anger and triggers, what brings us to a state of rage and anger, and what triggers us and gets our blood flowing. Not to not feel anger and rage, because again, all emotions, all feelings, I believe, are sacred and are of value. But if we get lost in that anger or do things to harm ourselves and others from that anger or from that triggers, to find a healthy relationship with that. Judging ourselves and others. Can we see all others, as they say in Tibetan Buddhism, that everyone at one point has been our mother? So can we treat all people, even if we don't love our mother, with that type of respect and love and compassion and humility, seeing all others as God, ultimately? And then I added a sixth one, get out into nature, having a relationship to nature and being in nature as often as possible. And then there they are. Fear, ego, anger, triggers, judging others and ourselves, seeing all as God, and get out into nature or live in nature. Okay, so in closing, going now to more of a general state with all this, some suggested practices for Westerners, putting all this together. This is some stuff I did that I am just sharing with you. Purification of diet, environment, friends, and I'm still doing. Purification of diet, environment, friends, family, and toxins. So just what's not serving us, it's just not working, it's serving us in a way that's bringing out the best of us and who we are in our life, we start to eliminate or transmute or view differently. Do a physical practice like yoga, qigong, or et cetera, something that includes breath work and a practice like a practice like pranayama, something with breath and movement, daily meditation practice to master mind, emotions, and energies, whatever meditation works for you, a basic understanding of the laws of the universe, like the law of attraction, karma. And then one must find, I in my opinion, a real teacher or a community of people or a spiritual friend, if you can, that can assist with all this. And then if you possible, take once a year to go on a retreat, whether that's a vacation or joining one of these different Buddhist retreats or Christian or what have you retreats where you can have deep rest. You can move into deep healing and relaxation or do a specific practice. I also feel it's very important to go do one's deep healing from any trauma. We talked about this in your life or past life, shadow work, remover of all negative energetic cords from the past, doing cord cuttings, and also entity removal and depossessions. Important to note that one does not have to show interest in Buddhism or yoga or any practices of this rainbow body teachings. And you can find a spiritual practice that works for you. Stick with it and go all the way with it until eventually you find that all things are the practice and all people are the teacher and all things are sacred. Okay, so even more simplified, suggested simplified practices for Westerners. Again, all these suggestions, if practice should be done under the guidance of a trained teacher and facilitator. Hatha yoga, eating high vibrational foods, meditation, mindful, consensual, loving sex, gentle fasting, qigong, mantra, chanting, kirtan, doing your shadow work, being happy and joyful as much as possible, artistic expression, doing what you love as much as possible, doing nothing, finding the peace of just being and doing nothing, and then being in nature, living in nature. And then the final simplified list of community, so finding support, finding community of people that you connect with, that support you and nourish you. You have the same maybe goals and interests, retreat, specific time to devote to rest and a specific practice, and find a guide, someone who has or knows the map of what you want and can assist in your healing and awakening journey. My recent realization, aha moment, I kind of already talked about this, but I'm doing a documentary on the Tibetan Rainbow Body and Light Body, and I've interviewed 10 people so far, some amazing people. And I talked to Lauren Roche and his wife Camille, who wrote the book The Radiant Sutras, which is from a very old tantra. He translated it, and we were talking about the Rainbow Body, and he said how he's seen over 30 years, he's like a meditation coach, therapist, that people who take on these practices, who are finding, like myself, have a great attraction to Buddhism and yoga, and they read a book or they go to a workshop or a retreat or what have you, or nowadays the internet, they watch some videos and they're like, oh, okay, Tummo, this looks cool, like this result, I wanna feel good, okay, I'm just gonna do this. And it could have tremendous benefit on your path and your journey and bring about positive results, but from my experience, and from others' experience that I've seen, if you don't have a teacher and a guide and you don't tread lightly with it, it could have some hazards and dangers by just taking these practices that come from meditation traditions and just applying them to our life kind of haphazardly or prematurely. Not to say they, even if they harm us, that isn't part of our path, but that it can, that's again other people's paths, that these practices and are designed for specific people living in specific areas who are living their life in a specific way. And I think if we take part of these practices like yoga and meditation and so on and do them in a safe way with a teacher, it can definitely have positive effects. But to like go deep into Dzogchen and try to practice it and do the practices while living your life, while sitting in traffic, while being a parent, while having a job, it could be, from my experience, extreme side effects that aren't very positive because those practices weren't designed for people like us. So that's why part of the reason why I created this is to find what a practice ways of being, quote unquote, ways of living are for people who are interested in these ways of living, but living in this world. So that was my big aha moment, is like, I knew that, but then I after having an experience I just went through, and then hearing my teacher Lauren say that just kind of like really hit me, like, wow, like that totally makes sense to me. So thank you for letting me repeat that kind of same statement over in different ways. It's just really fresh in me right now. And here's a video by Tool that has Alex Gray's art that shows a visual of what could be going on when one has a rainbow body experience, or your body is activated, your light body activated. So yeah, I believe that the rainbow body, this thing closing, is something, is again the Tibetan's form of the activated Kundalini light body energy that lives within all of us. It's something that we all have. It is what we are. It's what all things are made of. It seems that these beings that dissolve into light are just the elements that make up us, and all things are just like evaporate, like unfolding into what is. None of this is real. This is all energy. Everything is energy. And some of the, there seems to be practices or ways of living and being where when some people die, their bodies just re-emerge with what we are and with what is out here. And I believe, I have an idea that if this is just the natural way of people dying, all beings dying throughout the whole universe. I think that if we didn't have certain beliefs and sicknesses and karmas and poisons and what have us on top of us, on top of our natural way of being, that we would just all die in this way. But we all have these things that we're working through and transmuting. And maybe that's why when we die, the body just dies and we just start rotting and go back to the earth. But really, we're all made of light and darkness and space. And if we work through those traumas and purify our karma and purify our bodies and purify our minds and be in a life of service and none of love and live, see all as sacred and see all as the spiritual practice, all is holy. And to live that, that seems to be a way that results in this, from my opinion, from what I've seen. So what will you choose? To evolve digitally and artificially, or spiritually and organically? Is this the type of reality you want? Again, now, no right or wrong, no good or bad. It's just, this is what's currently going on Earth in one timeline. So is this the power we want? And is this the timeline we want to go down? Or this? So again, I'm making a documentary called Body of Light. And it's featuring interviews with different scholars and yogis and mystics and people who have vast knowledge on the Tibetan Rainbow Body and Light Body. It's something we can talk about more if you'd like. Go to torrentcollective.com to find out more information about that, or you can find me on Instagram or Facebook and whatnot, Body of Light. And thank you very much. Stop.
What was it for you?